Noen ganger må man våge å være idioten i rommet. Mitt navn er Kristina Pletten. Jeg er kommentator i Aftenposten. Og dette er ikke mitt motto, selv om noen sikkert mener det er passende. Men det er et sitat fra mannen dere straks skal få møte. Han har gjennom hele sin karriere oppsøkt mennesker som tenker og lever annerledes. Og han har turt å gå inn i de mørkeste avkrokene i samfunnet og stille spørsmål og forsøkt å forstå hvorfor folk tenker som de gjør. Og det er det han mener med å våge å være idioten i rommet. Det har gjort han til en prisbelønt journalist. Det har gjort han rett og slett til en av verdens beste intervjuere. Og som ikke det var nok da, så har han det siste året også klart å bli berømt som rapper på TikTok. So, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Louis Theroux.
You remember any of the rap that you do? My money don't jiggle, jiggle, it's cold, so like to see you wiggle, wiggle, for sure, and think you want to dribble, dribble. You know, riding in my Fiat, you really have to see it, 6'2" in a compact, no slack, but luckily the seats go back, I got a knack to relax in my mind, sipping some red, red wine.
I sit bruised from chalices, holding my palaces, grip is so fragile going. Oh my God, we're going to get the whole second verse.
Oh my goodness. So yeah, so as I mentioned in my intro, you sort of added a layer to your career the last year by becoming a rap star.
Yes.
How did that happen?
It wasn't on my to-do list. I'd like to take credit for having incredible rhyming skills. The truth is, I think, like a lot of things in this world we inhabit now, it was a side effect of social media. I'm a kind of TikTok sensation, but I think for whatever reason, something about the rap got intertwined with the algorithms that drive TikTok, and then it became 2 billion times viewed across the world.
The eighth most viewed video on TikTok?
You know, I'm going to make it, can I kind of draw a bigger point around that? Because I was thinking about it before we came out here, and someone was asking me about Andrew Tate. And you know, I'm sure a lot of you are aware of him. He's been in the news recently. He was arrested in Romania. And I was saying that, I don't think his message is much different from things that people have been saying for hundreds of years. Like, there have been poisonous and misogynistic views that have been written about, you know, as thousands of years ago, probably in Roman times. The difference is now there's something, you know, called social media, specifically in his case, TikTok. So, and by the same token, this is where the connection is. You know, it's not really, this isn't false modesty, really about my skills as a rapper that created a global, it was a TikTok thing. And by the same token, it's not really about Andrew Tate's, necessarily his appeal as a promoter of misogynistic ideas. He's a side effect of a social media algorithm. Mm. Although I'd like to be able to say it was really about my talent.
But you're not really here as a rapper, though, we have to say. You're here because you've spent so much time with people who are living and thinking outside the box, way outside the box.
That's a nice way of putting it.
It's a nice way of putting it. And this is a quote from an interview that you recently gave, where you said, "I've spoken to neo-Nazis, gangster rappers, and people in all kinds of outsider cultures. And people ask me, why don't you get annoyed with them? And I say, because I just want to hear what they got to say." Mm-hmm. And I'm wondering, what is it about people on the fringes of society that fascinates you so much?
Oh, wow. So you're making me the subject of inquiry now. You know, I wish I had a good answer for that. I do know that it's the question I'm asked most often. And the idea that, oh, you must be holding back. You must really be biting your tongue, because who else would spend 3 weeks with the Westboro Baptist Church in Kansas, right? Who go around holding placards that say offensive, homophobic things like fags eat poop and so on. And there I am just sort of politely interrogating them. The truth is like I feel no strong urge to confront. And if anything, I have to slightly G myself up in order to be more confrontational. I struggle with, okay, this is probably more information than you needed. I struggle with anxiety, or at least I have over the years, and I struggle with a sort of sense of almost uncertainty about what it is that I really believe, and you know, almost a sense of inauthenticity, which I think probably is maybe not that uncommon. I don't know. I can't see into anyone else's brains, but there's a sort of sense in which I worry that other people have found out something true about life that maybe I haven't found out yet.
So and have they? I mean, what have you learned from...
That's the reassuring part of doing my job and why I enjoy it so much, because I find out that people are more confused than I am. Right? Which is a nice feeling.
But I mean, you've met so many people who have sort of fallen down a rabbit hole or come into this fringe thinking one way or the other. Do you see any commonalities between them? Are there certain personality traits? I mean, could it happen to any of us?
I think, you know, the watchword that I sometimes use is a phrase used by the German philosopher Friedrich Nietzsche. I try not to quote Nietzsche too much because it makes me sound really pretentious, but there's a quote he gave in one of his books where he says, madness in individuals is rare, but in nations, in religions, in societies, it is the norm. And I think, you know, this idea that we are immune to irrationality is probably the most common misconception that we have, right? We all carry with us aspects of our belief. We've all been, in one sense, radicalized from the moment of birth. We've just been radicalized into the viewpoint of those that we grow up with, right? And I don't mean to get too, like, deep and philosophical, but, you know, I try not to be overly complacent about the idea that I've sort of arrived at a position of perfect humanity from which to judge the people that I'm among. So, yes, I think we're all susceptible to being radicalized. I think in some senses we've already been radicalized. I do also think that, you know, mental illness exists on a continuum. You know, I made three programs that went out this year, and all of them, in all of these worlds, one was about gangster rappers in Florida. One was about sex workers in LA, and one was about the far-right neo-Nazis.
And just let me add, you can see these three programs on NRK on the website if you want to see them.
And look, I don't mean to in any way stigmatize mental illness, but I saw aspects of mental illness in all of those worlds, you know. I think there's a sense in which we have frailties, all of us, whether we care to admit it or not, that mean that in the wrong situation we could behave in ways that were unhealthy.
But they also find some sense of community, connection to other human beings. Is that also a part of it, that you're finding someone that believe in the same thing that you do?
Absolutely, and in fact, that
goes... Common purpose, almost.
A sense of common purpose. Sometimes I look back at all the programs I've made and I think, does this add up to anything? Like, is there anything that I've learned, or have I just gone and met a bunch of weird people and thought, how weird they are, wow. Now I can go home and kiss my wife and put my kids to bed. I do think one of the things, this is going to sound trivial, but in many worlds that I go into, they involve people who've changed their names, right, in a sense. So in the world of porn, you use a porn name. In gangster rap, you use a gangster rap name. And even in the far right, many of them have online avatars, right? They go by their online identities. And I think what that tells you is that there's a sense of tribal identity, and there's a sense in which they've created a code and a world which makes sense to them, where they find a sense of belonging. And I think also that connects with the idea of social media, because in the past, that tribe or that village would have existed, like, maybe in tiny communities. You would have had to make a big commitment and move to a far-right, little far-right village in Idaho, or go and commit to being in LA and working as a sex worker. But nowadays, these people find each other online, and so the communities grow and influence society to a much greater extent.
And you could say that, you know, the expression fringe thinking is even a little bit strange to use today, because it's no longer only on the fringe, and we've seen conspiracies and these ideas travel all the way into the White House and beyond. And is it fair to say, do you think, that fringe thinking now is also like a political strategy?
Definitely.
I mean, a political tool?
We think about Trump. He's obviously exhibit A in any discussion about conspiracy thinking or the ways in which radicalized thinking has influenced the mainstream. Let's recall that when he first launched his first presidential bid in 2012, it was on the back of what's called Burfagate, right? The idea that Obama had been born in Kenya. I remember reading about that and thinking, like, this guy's bonkers. Like, he's a ridiculous orange-haired gibbon man, right? Who's obviously just utterly cynical. I mean, I'm fairly phlegmatic in my political views, and when I see weird people on TV, I normally think, wow, that's great. I love seeing weird stuff. But even with Trump, I thought, that's kind of disgusting to go on TV promoting such outrageous bigotry, like quasi-racist, or actually outwardly racist bigotry. And yet, that was his foothold, and he had an instinct for conspiratorial thinking that would go on to be his whole playbook, right down to what we've seen, the Stop the Steal movement and the big lie of the idea of the rigged or stolen election. And I think what we see in conspiracies is a form of the most potent kind of storytelling. Mm. And as much as we like to believe that we're animated through life, that we're motivated by a quest for truth, the thing I've discovered is actually, if we're honest, we realize what motivates us is a quest for meaning and an idea that we are the heroes of the stories we tell ourselves. And there's nothing that tells you quite such a compelling story is the idea that you've seen through reality, you've seen through the matrix, and that you alone, or you and your small community of like-minded compadres, have seen the truth, and that there's evildoers at work, and that you are going to take up your sword and fight them. And that's really what Trump is playing into, and has done with great success for a number of years.
So what you're saying is that a conspiracy theory, to be successful, it has to have some kind of hidden meaning or something that you feel like you see through it where nobody else does.
The most effective conspiracy theories, I think, have a number of traits. But one is the idea that you are one of a chosen, a chosen elect who are thereby, from seeing the truth, endowed with a kind of heroism. And as a corollary of that, the idea that there are evildoers, a shadowy band of evildoers. You need an enemy who's withholding the truth and pulling the strings. And with those two are the important ones. And then something kind of seductive that feels like it's some obvious truth that's hidden in plain sight. In a way, the most perfect one is the flat earth, the idea of a flat earth conspiracy, right? Because on one level, it's like, yeah, I guess the earth is flat, right? You look around, it does look pretty flat, you know? You know, there's a reason why they don't say it's a cube. You know what I mean? Because actually, people are like, that's ridiculous. There would be corners. But actually, if someone says, well, think for yourself, and doesn't it look flat? And then that's the seeds of a great conspiracy theory because it has some immediate plausibility to it. By the way, the Earth is not flat.
But,
thank you. Just to get that out there.
Also, I think what we've seen in the past few years is how powerful these mechanisms are, how powerful a conspiracy theory can be also as a political tool, that it really doesn't just reach a little band of people. It can reach millions. It can win you the White House.
I mean, absolutely. I mean, and it's extraordinary. It used to be that I had to go up to Idaho in order to hear about the idea that the federal government needed to be abolished, right? That was a common belief among the militia community. I made a program in 1996. It was about these survivalist militia guys who thought the world was ending and that the federal government would be basically taking Americans' guns away. And the idea in the background was that really what they needed to do was declare war on the federal government and go and burn down the White House or burn down Congress. So, you know, it was pretty weird stuff. That was in, as I say, 1996. And then I thought these guys are going to fizzle out, you know, come 2000, when the world doesn't end, they'll be like, oh, I guess I was wrong about that. Never mind, I'll go back to my job as a trucker. Instead, which is what one of them did, but anyway, instead, we saw in 2021 almost a full fruition of exactly those beliefs with January 6th, and literally hordes of Americans were marching on Washington to, I guess, burn down the Capitol building, or at very least, they invaded it. And it's just amazing to see how the landscape has changed so much that what used to be fringe thinking is now, I won't call it exactly mainstream, but it's so much closer to the mainstream.
What is the mainstream anyway? But where is this heading then? You talked about social media. They're getting bigger and bigger, more and more powerful. The internet is not going anywhere. So no. Is this the new normal? Do we just have to get used to it?
I don't, you know, I think it's hard to say, but I think there are reasons for optimism, actually. I think what we've seen is an attempt to regulate social media that's been clumsy and sometimes counterproductive, but other times it's been helpful, I think. 2018, it seems to me, was almost a kind of tipping point, possibly. That was when there was recognition that algorithms on Facebook and elsewhere were driving antisocial behavior. And I think we saw in both 2018 and 2020 in America the results of a populace that was kind of growing tired of the same stories about QAnon and conspiratorial thinking and, oh, politicians and Bill Gates is snatching your babies and Soros is taking your baby because he wants to take a blood transfusion from your babies. Did you follow that whole one? And you know, they were like, you know what, I've heard that, I've seen that movie, I've heard that narrative and I'm bored and now I'm just worried about healthcare and my job. Right. And I think new stories, and I think that was why Trump lost, and I think that there's a sense in which there are new stories. You know, the QAnon, you know, the whole QAnon phenomenon is still there, but it's fizzling, and it feels as though people have got to... I remember, I know we haven't got long, but I remember there was a whole story in the mid-90s about aliens were helping to build U.S. aircraft at Area 51. Do you remember? And it was like, they're working alongside U.S. engineers using captured technology from Roswell. And for a while, it felt like a really cool, seductive idea because there was a secret base there. And then what happened? People just got tired. They just kind of got bored of that story.
So I don't know if that can be described as hopeful, but it's like at least...
I think that's
some
hopeful.
Sort of... We can
I think we see that there's a period of traction. There's a period of virality. It's a bit like, you know, we started with Jiggle Jiggle. Like, I wish that Jiggle Jiggle would be top 10 on TikTok for the whole of 2023. Like, I don't really, but you know, like, these things have a moment of virality. And I think, if I can draw this back to you and I, we're both journalists and we try and tell the truth in our work, but I also think we also try to tell stories that connect with people. You know, and this goes across the board in the world of politics, in the world of business. If you drill down, and we're all, in a sense, communicators attempting to relate to people, to build rapport, to build relationships. And I think that hinges on our ability to tell stories and to tell better stories that connect with people and that unite them in building a better future.
So we have to find a better story.
Better stories, yeah. I can help.
Thank you so much,
Louis, I can do a rap over it.
Coming. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Thank you.